Hello everyone and welcome. The 2022 Volkswagen Golf R has a front-wheel drive based all-wheel drive system, and yet it is capable of drifting. So this is all thanks to a very clever rear differential, and in this video we're going to explain how it all works. Now, to understand why Volkswagen has chosen to go with this new style of differential, let's compare the previous generation Mark 7 all-wheel drive system with the current generation, the Mark 8 Golf R, and we can get a better understanding of why they're switching over to this new design. So starting with the previous generation, you have your engine sending power through the transmission to this front bevel box. So this bevel box is not only spinning this front differential, powering those front tires, but it is also sending that power back through this rear drive shaft to an all-wheel drive coupling. So if this all-wheel drive coupling is opened up, well, you're basically just powering those front wheels. This is like a front-wheel drive system, so if you're driving down the highway, you can maximize efficiency. Now, if you close up this clutch pack back here, this all-wheel drive coupling, then you're sending torque to those rear wheels as well, and it's doing so through an open rear differential. So that open differential splits torque left and right, 50-50 on both sides. So what happens if you don't have much traction on one of these tires? Well, they both get 50%. So you don't get much torque to either. So what do you do? Well, you use the brake to apply the brakes to the wheel that is slipping, and then you can send more torque overall to the back and get more torque to that tire that does have traction. But of course, there's losses associated with doing this because you're using the brakes to help increase the torque going to the back. So what does the new system do? Well, up front, very similar. You have that bevel box sending power to both the front differential as well as this drive shaft going to the rear axle. And then the rear axle, you have what is more similar to a spool drive, meaning, you know, both of these tires are going to rotate together, but you have these two clutch disconnects basically for each axle. So each axle has its own clutch pack to disconnect from this. So you can open up both of these clutch packs here, and then you're no longer sending power to those rear wheels. So again, driving down the highway, if you don't want to send torque to those rear wheels, you can just open up these clutch packs and you're just driving those front tires. Now the difference here is you can now choose how much torque goes to either wheel. So in scenarios like cornering, where you want to send more torque to that outside tire, you can choose to send up to 100% of the torque to whichever wheel you want, or 0% to the other by opening up that clutch pack. And you can vary the pressure of these clutch packs in order to choose how much torque do we want going to each wheel. So it's a much better system as far as torque vectoring is concerned. It's going to allow for better handling, better performance coming out of corners. And then also another clever application of this used in the Tiguan R, which is not sold in North America, but in other markets, they use it like a locked differential for off-road. So when it's off-road mode, you can lock up both of these clutch packs fully, and then it acts like a locked differential. And of course, that means torque goes to wherever it's needed. Both tires are always going to be rotating at the same speed. That's not done on the Golf R because the Golf R is driven on roads, not necessarily off-road. So they don't have that off-road mode where it basically acts like a locked differential. All right, so how does this rear torque splitter work? So let's zoom in on this portion right here, looking at this right clutch pack and see what's going on in order to vary, you know, how much torque you're getting to each individual wheel. So we still have our final drive right here. So you've got that axle coming back like we do here, and then it's driving this ring gear right here, which is rotating our axle, which ultimately is going over to our driven tire and wheel there. So if you ignore that, you just have that axle going across. Now, ignoring this section right here, we just have our clutch pack, right? So there's our clutch pack, and that's going to be driving our wheels. And then this little section right here is how we're actually activating, closing in and engaging this clutch, or opening and disengaging this clutch. So how does this section work? Well, in green here, we have a thrust bearing. Then we have an electric motor right here, and that electric motor drives a worm gear, which attaches to a setting ring. So this setting ring has teeth on it. And so you can see as this worm gear rotates, it's going to cause this setting ring to rotate because of those teeth from that worm gear rotating. So the worm gear gives you very fine control of how much adjustment you're putting into this, which ultimately leads to how much are you compressing in, you know, that clutch pack in order to provide torque to that wheel. So how does that work? Well, you have this rotate, right? And so attached to this setting ring, we have these ball ramps. So looking right here, you can see that as you use this electric motor to rotate this setting ring, and you have these ball ramps right here with this ball, as you force this blue section, this dark blue section down, well, that's going to force this ball up, and it's squeezing it, it's pinching it in that ramp. So as you move that down, you can see that's going to force your setting ring to push axially into this thrust bearing and then compress into that clutch pack. So you squeeze and engage that clutch pack. So how much you squeeze it in is of course based on where is this ball in relationship to this ramp, and then you're controlling that with your electric motor. So you have very fine control there of the pressure that you have applied to that clutch pack, and thus very fine control of how much torque you're going to be sending, because if you open this all the way up, this just freely spins, and you just have a little bit of drag within this clutch pack, and then as you apply that pressure, you of course have clutch slip until the point where you fully lock it up, and then you would be sending, assuming the other side is open, you'd be sending 100% of the torque to that one wheel. So looking at this, you know, there's going to be a duplicate of this on the other side for the other axle. So now that we understand how the all-wheel drive system works, how does this drift mode specifically work? So let's walk through the scenario as we're going around this left-hand corner here. So we have our wheels turned in on the front, of course, and let's say at this point we have our rear clutch packs open. The system is operating like a front-wheel drive based vehicle. And so you're driving those front tires and you're going around this corner. So now we're loading up those outside tires, and so the front is not only doing the work of turning the car, but it's also doing the work of accelerating the car. So in that scenario, you're overloading those front tires, right? You need to get torque to the back so that you don't just understeer or just push the car forward. So you start to lock up these clutch packs here a bit more, applying pressure to them, and that allows you to send torque to the rear, giving you more neutral handling. Well, what if you intentionally want to drift, which is what the whole point of this drift mode, selectable drift mode, is? Well, what they do in that scenario, instead of splitting the torque between the left and the right tire, they send all of it to that outside tire, to that right tire. So the right tire on the front and the back are loaded up because you're going around that corner, and now you're sending all of the available rear torque, all of the torque that's going to the rear of the car is going just to that outside tire. So you overload it, it's getting too much torque, it's trying to hold the car in the corner, and it's trying to accelerate the car with all of the rear torque. And so what it does is it just overloads that tire, it breaks free and starts to spin. So then the rear of the car oversteers, you countersteer to correct it. If you do so well enough, you hold that drift for a little bit. Now, the interesting thing about this is, of course, it's all-wheel drive, right? And so we don't have a difference in speed between the front drive shafts and the rear drive shaft as far as the power input is concerned. So that means, you know, as that rear kicks out, the front tires are rotating at basically the same speed as those rear tires, and they're still receiving torque. So the front tires are really trying to pull you out of that drift. So it'll happen for a short little bit, but because this is an all-wheel drive system, and because you're going to have the same rotational speeds, front and rear, it's going to be very difficult to maintain that drift. It'll allow it to pop out, but it's going to be difficult to maintain. And basically, an easy way of thinking about how it does this is, it's a lot like yanking a handbrake for a single outside tire, except in reverse. Instead of applying the brakes, you're applying torque. And so you're overloading the tires that way, forcing the rear to rotate out, oversteer. Then the front, of course, is going to catch it. It's all-wheel drive. It's going to pull itself back. But you will have that little slide. So that's what the drift mode is doing. Now, Volkswagen wasn't the first to use an all-wheel drive system like this. In fact, the Range Rover Evoque will look very similar to this, as well as the Ford Focus RS. And there's another very interesting thing about the Ford Focus RS, which again uses a very similar all-wheel drive system that the Volkswagen Golf R Mark 8 is using. So with the Focus RS, very similar as far as front wheel drive base, the front wheels are always driven and you send torque to the back when needed using this similar spool type rear differential, where you have these two clutch packs that you can choose how much torque do you want to go to either side. The interesting thing done with the Focus RS is that they used a taller rear gearing by about 1.8%. So that taller gearing means that rear gearing gear is rotating these rear wheels at a faster speed than the front wheels. So you have this bind in the system, essentially. One of two things has to slip. Either you have the clutch pack slip here going to these two rear wheels, or you have the rear wheels themselves actually slipping because the rear axle wants to rotate faster than the front axle and they're connected, right? So something has to slip. So the clever thing about that is it means once these rear tires are spinning, they're actually going to be rotating faster than the front tires when you're drifting. So in the Ford Focus RS drift mode, when you get that thing to slide out, those rear tires are actually spinning faster than the front, which is of course what you want in a drift in order to maintain it. So it is still all-wheel drive and it's still going to try and pull you out of it. If you want to really drift, just get a rear-wheel drive car where you can easily have the rear wheels spinning much faster than the front wheels and maintain that slide. But the way it's done on the Focus RS from a drifting standpoint is beneficial because you're actually able to have a quicker speed of those rear tires. Now the downside there is that you're going to put a lot of slip into that clutch in normal driving, because during normal driving, you don't want to have the tires always spinning, right? So that means that clutch pack takes up the slip for the all-wheel drive system. Now, of course, the engineers know this. They think about this. They consider the heat going into it and have to design accordingly. And basically what's going to happen is if that rear diff, if these clutch packs start to get way too hot, they're going to minimize how much torque they're actually sending to the back, open them up, allow them to cool down. But it is a clever system from a drifting standpoint. Now, a common question with all-wheel drive systems is what is the torque split front and rear? A lot of people want to know how much torque is going to the front, how much torque is going to the rear. Now, with vehicles like this, where you don't have a center differential, it's a very dangerous question to ask because it's very easy to get confused on what the torque split actually is. So it's not really something that should be talked about from a torque split standpoint with vehicles like this where you don't have a center differential. I spoke with an engineer at Dana who works on all the different kinds of all-wheel drive systems to get a better understanding of kind of why this is. And basically it acts like a part-time four-wheel drive system when you engage these rear clutches. So when you engage these rear clutches, it's a lot like a truck. Any pickup truck that you can go from two-wheel drive into four-wheel drive. It's like selecting that. And you don't ask, you know, what's the torque split in those systems? The torque goes to whichever axle has traction. So in a scenario where the Focus RS doesn't have any grip at all on those front tires, they're in the air or something like that, they're just on ice, almost all of your torque is going to be going to the back because the two axles are linked, much like a part-time four-wheel drive system. So the torque goes wherever the torque is needed. It takes the path of, hey, here's where I can put it down because these two axles are linked together. Same in this scenario here. If the two axles, if these clutch packs are locked up, the torque's going to go, wherever it can put that torque down between the front and the rear axle. Now, as far as left to right, that's dependent on the differential use. So if it's an open differential like the front, well, it's a 50-50 split. If you lock everything up, well, then you can send 100% to either side. So again, torque split, not something that's kind of good to talk about when you don't have a clear-cut center differential and you're saying, okay, this differential is splitting the torque like so. This percent goes here, that percent goes there. It's a bit more complicated of a question. Overall though, a neat implementation of this style of rear drive unit and how they've incorporated this drift mode into the 2022 Volkswagen Golf R. If you have any questions or comments, of course, feel free to leave those below. Thanks for watching.